have a song? Yes, sister. 369. Yes, brother. 226? 226. Let us turn to hymn 350. Hymn 350. Nearer, my God, to thee.
Thank you.
One more song, yes. 440. Hymn 440. When peace like a river.
Thank you.
conclude our song service. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Let us stand for a moment of silent prayer. Our hymn for the morning will be hymn number 162. 162. Reading this morning is taken from the book of Ephesians chapter 3, verses 9, 10, and 11. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 9, 10, and 11. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world have been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. With these words in our hearts this morning, let us kneel for our opening prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before thy throne of grace this morning to thank you for your loving kindness and tender mercies. Thank you for all the blessings that thou hast bestowed upon us. We pray and ask your presence now at this conference, that your Holy Spirit may be felt in our hearts and in our minds, and that we will do the things we need to do to be saved and to help others also. We ask that you forgive us for our shortcomings and our sins,
Bless all those who are coming out this morning, and bless those who could not make it. We thank you for your love, and we praise you for your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to welcome everyone out this morning. Before we begin, please make sure all your cell phones are turned off or on mute as we have these services. Our thought this morning is taken from Acts of the Apostles, page 600. The church is God's agency for the proclamation of truth, empowered by him to do a special work. And if she will be loyal to him, if she will be obedient to his commandments, they would dwell within her the excellency of divine grace. If she will be true to her allegiance to God, if she will honor the Lord, God of Israel, there is no power that will stand against her. So the church is a power on earth, and we as God's people must reflect his image, must reflect his character in all things. This time we're going to have our classes now. The Spanish class will be done by Brother Howell. They'll be in the dining area. The youth class will be taught by Brother George. The children from ages 8 to 12 will be taught by Brother Bell. Brother Hazelhoff will be teaching the main lesson, and Brother Gennady will be giving the review lesson. Let's all be back here in the sanctuary, at least no later than 10:40. The classes may separate now as the review begins.
Good morning, everyone. I'd like to say happy Sabbath to all of you present here and also to our online listeners. Happy Sabbath. That's it. Sounds more unanimous. When we were driving yesterday to this place from Roanoke, Vanessa fell asleep, my youngest daughter, as maybe half an hour as we left Roanoke. So she woke up when we were in a Dallas area already. And says, wow, we're already here? So she was kind of surprised and said, I didn't even notice how we arrived. This story I brought just as an illustration that sometimes, especially our younger generation, they belong or they choose their membership in the Reform movement of Seventh-day Adventists. But they don't know how they arrived to be reformers. So people kind of know a little bit about the Christ, his crucifixion, Acts of Apostles, then they don't know anything, and then here I am, a reformer. What happened in between these 2,000 years? So before we will be studying the God's purpose for his church, our mission as church, where we are coming from, why we exist as a reform movement. So let us review quickly a lesson which gives us a previous lesson we studied last Sabbath, God's church in the last days, and it gives kind of a very, very short, very brief survey through a history. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Dragon. Who is dragon? The devil. Now, he is in war. With whom? With the remnant. Before we'll come back to this verse, let's go in a history. Why? I mean, remnant means something that what remains out of multitude. So what happened to multitude in the history? Let's go back in the 3rd, 4th, 5th century. So what happened with Christianity? So persecution ceased around 310 AD. Persecution ceased. Freedom came to Roman Empire for Christians. What happened to Christianity? Yes, sister.
We became more worldly and lost the peculiarity and the specifics of God and mimicked the world into the blended. The line of demarcation has been erased.
Thank you. They blended with paganism. So in order to convert the whole Roman Empire into the new religion, they decided that, well, look, you give something of yours, they give something up of yours, and we create kind of a third, a combination, a combo, a perfect set which will satisfy everyone. It satisfied everyone except for a little group of people. What they had to do as a result? Did they want to separate? No. They had no intention whatsoever to separate. But finally they had to do it. Why? So they could obey God. So, yes, sister. Thank you. That was pointed very to the point. They had no choice. After a long and severe conflict, the faithful few decided to dissolve all union with the apostate church if she still refused to free herself from falsehood and idolatry. Look, we want to be back with you. We will be back and we will serve God together. But give up your idols. But we know from the history that never happened. But what happened instead? So the main church, the mainstream, instead of giving up their idols, what they did to these few peoples? Exactly. They started to persecute them. And over centuries, they were persecuting them. And everywhere in the mountains, as we remember the Waldensians, and as we remember church in England, and then church in Germany, and France, and Swiss, and all the European countries, they had churches, they had group of people, they had individuals, which we call them now reformers. There was a reformation movement in a Catholic church. What they were reforming, what they tried to change. Speaking, for example, of a Luther, did he have any intention to separate himself from a Roman Catholic church? No, we know from the history, no. Why he ended up being in the opposite camp? Yes.
He discovered that the church he was in was not teaching anything according to what thus saith the Lord.
Okay, but that's not a reason that he wanted to separate from the church. He wanted to reform the church. Did he succeed?
No.
They pushed him out. And that's always happened in the history from the time of Christ. Disciples, followers of Jesus, they were pushed out of the chosen nation. Then they were pushed out from the mainstream church because they blended their teaching or doctrines with the idolatry. Yes. Yes, they were forced. They had no other choice. So either you yield and become like the apostate church, or if you want to stick with the gospel or with the true, pure doctrine, then you have to suffer consequences, which is persecution and all the mocking, and finally it's death. Because many of them were killed.
The choice that they made was not to separate themselves from God. And
exactly.
Then, because those who were choosing to do otherwise, that kind of separation, it wasn't that they chose to leave, the people were not choosing. They chose to follow God and face whatever consequences it was. Because as the Hebrew boy said, we're not careful of being out with our entity because we know what God is saying. And likewise, they
Speaking of a time, yes, brother.
If it didn't, they would have concluded themselves. You are who you're around. They've already commanded pure ahead of them.
Thank you. Speaking of a time, we know from the prophecy that there were 1,260 prophetical days, which we understand is 1,260 years. During those times, the Catholic Church was really in power. They were controlling not only doctrines, they were controlling even kings. Their earthly powers, their earthly authorities, they were in a full submission to Roman Catholic Church. Kings were obeying the Pope. Pope was leading armies, the Crusades. And during this time of persecution, the prophecy said, Jesus said that those days will be shortened. So what make those days to be shortened? Reformers, yes. Yes, but when one person says, this is wrong, they kill him. Another person says, this is wrong. They kill him. When 1,000 people says this is wrong, they were not able already to kill thousands and thousands. Even through sanctuaries, they kill millions. But yet, when the whole country like Germany says, voted, you know, we are for freedom, then the Roman Catholic Church had nothing to do. And thus, persecution was the time was shortened because of the reform movements, those great reformers and their followers. And they chose to follow Christ. But we come to the point in the history that to these reform movements, a message came. The Lord is coming soon. Be prepared for his judgment. They said, no. Hold on. We are reformers. We don't need any more new messages. We are reformers. Then there was a second angel message. You know what? Because you don't accept and you don't fear God and worship true God who created heaven and earth, who is going to judge all of us, then you become like your mother, apostate. And you are named now Babylon. Yes. We are not there yet. There was no reform movement in Adventist in those yet. We will come to that point. Yeah, just a little bit patience. So we, the reform movements, became apostate, and they lost their status as the Church of God. Then Adventist movement appeared. Why Adventist movement was necessary? Yes.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And the whole world was going to meet their Savior. But when he didn't come back at that time, then they got disappointed. They began to go back and blend. And that's why the second angel message came, because now you're Babylon.
Yes.
Okay, then the third angel message is a combination of all, because God is going to deliver his faithful remnant, which could be us, is us, if we follow, then God will come back and make the ultimate deliverance.
So the third angel message, and this message pointed to the Creator, to his day, sanctified by the Creator, and we are to worship in the day of the Lord, which is the seventh day of the week, which is Sabbath. And when Adventists started to preach this message, how many were they? I'm not talking worldwide, but as we know, recorded in a great controversy, about 50 people. It was a very, very few. But they started to move on. They had a message to deliver, the Sabbath day. Now, speaking of Babylon, whom today we can say that they are Babylon? There are certain criterias whom we can call a Babylon and whom we cannot call a Babylon. I want to read you just one paragraph from Evangelism 365, page 365. Listen carefully. Babylon has been fostering poisonous doctrines, the wine of error. This wine of error is made up of false doctrines, such as the natural immortality of the soul, the eternal torment of the wicked, the denial of pre-existence of Christ prior to his birth in Bethlehem, and advocating and exalting the first day of the week above God's holy sanctified day. These and kindred errors are presented to the world by the various churches. This is the wine of Babylon. This is what makes a certain church to be called, not by us, by the revelation at Babylon. If you stick to all of these doctrines or to one of these doctrines, then you pertain to Babylon. If you don't keep the Sabbath, you're there. If you believe in the immortality of the soul, you belong to that. Now, speaking of Adventist church, here we come. We've studied, if you remember, not long time ago, we've studied about a message given to Adventist Church in 1888. What was that message about? Christ, our righteousness. Now we are coming back to the key verse. That the dragon was in a war with whom? With a remnant. Remnant of whom? Remnant of the seed. So who is the seed? Jesus Christ. Exactly, it's Jesus Christ. You remember, Apostle Paul says very clear, speaking of Abraham, not as many, but as one seed. Who is? Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ himself, speaking in parallel, says, remember, the seed is the Word of God. And, well, we can study that, but the seed is Christ. And what is the remnant? Remnant are those who belong to Christ, so they have a living connection with Jesus, number one. Because they have living connection with Jesus, they are able to keep commandments. And because they have connection to Jesus, their eyes are open, because they are using eyesight, which is the testimony of Jesus, which is the spirit of prophecy. That is remnant. They have living connection with Jesus. They keep commandments. And they believe spirit of prophecy. And those people who stick to these three, which is everything starts with a seed, Jesus, then they are identified as a remnant. Well, our time is not permitting today, but I believe we'll have another study of a history of the Reform movement, why we appeared as a Reform movement. We just have here, it's a very short survey through a history, because the main purpose of this lesson is not history, but the purpose of God's church, our mission as today, what we are going to study. We just briefly went through history that we are existing today as the Reform movement. Does, my final question, my membership in the Reform movement, what it guarantees me? Nothing. Nothing. Okay, you see, some people use church as an insurance company just to secure their future. Brothers and sisters, Reform Movement is not an insurance company. Where is the insurance? Where is the security? 100% guarantee of the seed, which is Christ, or connection to Jesus, keeping commandments and believing the spirit of prophecy. This is guaranteed insurance. And with this, I say amen. And I invite Brother Paul.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. We're just going to continue right on in. Before I knock the mic over here, we'll just continue on right with the lesson about God's purpose for His church. And we could actually say God's purpose for His church is God's purpose for His people, for you and for me. Why can I say it's for me, or why can I say it's for you? Do you remember in the last quarter what we've been studying? We've been studying about Reformation. And where does the Reformation begin? First, it begins with you, right? No, it begins with me. It begins with me, then with you. I share it with you. But before it goes with you, I've got to share it with my family. I've got to be able to control my family. Then what happens? What does the church consist of? Of families. Then what does the church do? We need to spread it out. And the Bible text here that begins with, it says, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, to the intent that now unto the principalities and the powers in heavenly places might be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose which He proposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, Apostle Paul, in the verse right before this, he says, you know, why, he said, I'm less than the least of the saints. And a responsibility was given to me that I must preach to the Gentiles. That same commission that was given to him is also given to us. And we'll go a little bit into this here as we go into the fifth section of this lesson. But we still have to go back to the basics, and we've got to go back to the beginning. And whose image were we created in? In God's image. Now, who were the ones that made the plan? Was it one individual that made that choice? Yes, Brother Gillis. The Father. Yeah, there was a co-decision there that was made. Let us make man in our image. Our is a plural word. It's not a singular word. And we can see that this work was carried out. What do we call this? We are the crowning act of creation. He had just finished creating all the animals. And for what purpose did He create us? I'm kind of jumping around a little bit too, because we are going to run out of time. Yes. To glorify Him. That's right. And what does it mean to be created in God's image? You know, there are many gods, or so-called gods. There are many images. But what is the correct image? Yes. And what's His character? You notice in the note there, it mentions a couple of His characters and starts mentioning them. God made man upright. He gave him noble traits of character with no bias toward evil. He endowed him with high intellectual powers. Man's affections were pure. His appetites and passions were under the control of reason. Let me ask you, how hard is it to control any one of these now? How hard is it? We fail maybe in one or two of these or more. And this is what God wants to restore back as it was in the very beginning. And this is all because of the result of sin. Because of sin, the degradation or the process of downhill, it went rapidly. And if we look at our statue today compared with the statue of what it was with Adam and Eve as far as height-wise, size-wise, it's a completely different, there's a big contrast between the two because of sin, the appetite, the diet that was adopted after the fact versus the original diet that was proposed for man. We had mentioned a little bit about the purpose, what purpose God created humanity, and he has created man for his glory, as the sister had mentioned. And he mentions that I have formed man and I have made man. And it says, and above all lower orders of being, this is under the note under 2a, God designed that man, the crowning work of his creation, should express his thought and reveal his glory. But man is not to exalt himself as God. When Adam came from the Creator's hand, he bore in his physical, mental, and spiritual nature a likeness to his Maker. God created man in his own image, and it was his purpose that the longer man lived, the more fully he should reveal his image, the more fully reflect the glory of his Creator. And in just a minute, we'll see what the glory of God is and what his intention for man was. You know, in the next question here, it talks about when Moses was leading the children of Israel, and he had received the commandments, and he broke the commandments, and he was talking with Christ, and he was told to make a new set of stones to bring them before the Father, and he would engrave the same commandments that were given just previously into the stone with his own finger. And a question was asked to God, show me thy glory. Was the petition answered? How was it answered? Yes. So, you know, I like when you read this a little bit also, that he would put him up in a crevice in the side of the mountain, and as he would walk by, he would put his hand over his face, and when he walked by, the only thing that he was able to see was the backside. And you notice, though, that even when Moses came down to the children afterwards, were people able to face Moses? Now, this is an indirect contact with God. And we couldn't stand it. They had to put a veil in front of his face. And God told Moses also, said, look, if you would see my face, you would die. You know? And then as he passed, we see that the glory, God's glory, was revealed to Moses. And it says, the glory of God is his character. While Moses was in the mount, earnestly interceding with God, he prayed, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. In answer, God declared, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I'll proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. The glory of God, his character, was then revealed. I want to ask you a question. Yes.
Was this a physical manifestation of God? I'm kind of curious as to.
All right, she's asking the question, was this a physical manifestation of God? Sister Vicki.
God said to Moses, petition, he said, he would, but as you said, he would hide it, he would cover it. It's symbolic of Christ covering up with righteousness, because Christ revealed the glory of in its fullness through human body, right? So,
okay.
You said too, when he passed by, he only got to see his hind part. So, mercy and all that is just only a portion of God, because we will be able to be in the full presence of God without a mediator, so that His glory, to reflect His glory like we did from the beginning, so we're not consumed. Only because of Christ are we not consumed. And when Moses asked and God covered him, I believe that is symbolic of the righteousness of Christ mediating for man until we are able to stand in His presence.
We don't fully understand what Christ has actually done for us. And the more we find out that the more we are we really shouldn't accept it in a way of what, you know, because of our sin and our downfall of what God has done for us, and He still loved us. And we find out later that He died for us, for you and for me. And the character of God is very beautiful. What consists or what forms our character? I'm looking for one word. One word. No? What forms our characters? Read the last three words in that note. Habits do what? Form character. What habit do you practice? God revealed His glory to Moses, right? What was the glory that was revealed to him? Mercy, gracious, long-suffering. It goes through and it mentions any of those. If we practice those, guess what happens? Our character becomes strong and it becomes Christ-like. When we try to reveal our own characters, it goes completely opposite. Yes, sister? That's correct. And what we, the glory of God was revealed, the goodness and the truth, these are things that are in our mind. And what is inside will automatically come out. We'd want to share it with others as we share with our friends. Sister Lily, did you have something?
Yeah, I was going to say, thoughts plus feelings make our character.
That's right. That's right. Even at the beginning of the note, it talks about if the thoughts are wrong and the feelings will, if the thoughts are wrong, the feelings will be wrong. And the thoughts and feelings combined make up the moral character. When you decide that as Christians you are not required to restrain your thoughts and your feelings, you are brought under the influence of the evil angels and invite their presence and their control. Yes, Brother Silva.
Mm-hmm. It becomes a habit, then our character is formed according to God's word. Which I think that should stress this point, because God's word is too much neglected. And our mind is formed was what we put there.
You know, let me ask you this. What is a computer? A computer is something that stores information. And it all depends on what was put in that computer is what you will be able to retrieve. And I heard the famous saying, garbage in, garbage out. So what we feel we feed in, that will come out. So our thoughts have to be pure. We have to meditate and we need to concentrate on the things from above. Yes, sister. That's correct. That's a very good verse to read, and it kind of puts it in perspective. Going on is God's purpose thwarted. Upon what point did the serpent tempt our first parents? Appetite. Do you notice, even as we go from the very beginning toward the very end, that Satan uses our senses, our taste, our eyesights, our taste, our smell, our touch. And Christ even was tempted by the point of appetite. And he does it when you're at your lowest point. He goes after what you desire or what you want. And it might be very different from each and every one of us. But here, the point of appetite, that the fruit of the tree in the midst of the garden, they shall not eat of it, nor what? Touch it. If she would have touched it, you would have had the same results of the eating. Because why is that? When we think of something, the last result is what? The action. We've already done it in our mind. We just hadn't physically done it yet. Yes?
That was easy to say that God said not to touch, right? Because the scripture tells us that God
said
don't eat it.
Read some of the other verses. You cannot eat it or touch it. Yeah.
Eve over Satan is saying touch, and that's why the serpent was able to hand her that fruit, and she not see any change. That's why she then went on to taste of it, which would be to eat, which was the command that God said. So I don't see in the scripture, I haven't seen the scripture where it said the commandment, God doesn't give us any detail, but having the spirit of prophecy, and it says that Eve over Satan, had she not been away from Adam, she wouldn't have been tempted and all of that. But God, that's why the enemy was able to put that fruit in her hand, and then she'd still be allured because she didn't see any difference.
That's correct. Brother Dorval.
Yes, we see that the pattern begins in the mind.
That's right.
Where Jesus was tempted.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's right.
And never, as he says, you already touched. You're guilty anyway now. Go ahead and do whatever. This is the trap that we need to face with the word of God.
You know, Eve not only was the apple very appealing as far as looking to it, and obviously it tasted good once she ate it also, but also the eyesight of when it was looking and seeing the serpent on the tree. The serpent was one of the most beautiful animal, or was the beautifulest animal, that had wings. It had the look of a gold, a tarnished gold. And not only that, but the animal talking to her. You know, so you've got all these senses that are overwhelmed, and it must be true of what he's saying. And she didn't realize the small point that God said that we should not eat of that that fruit. And one of the things in the note here also that I like, health has been sacrificed on the altar of appetite. They ate and drank till the indulgence of their depraved appetite knew no bounds, and they became so corrupt that God could bear with them no longer. The cup of iniquity was full, and he cleansed the earth of its moral pollution by the flood. This is by Eating that fruit. And how successful was Satan in causing humans to sin? What is the thought of man? It's wicked. Every imagination, every thought of his heart was only evil continually. And then it says also that there's no righteous, no, not one. Yes, sister. Exactly.
You have an appetite to do things that don't relate to eating and drinking, but the appetite to be around a certain person, you know, other things, and that's not defined as food. But also, I think a lot of times when we place ourselves out of the presence of Christ, we rely on Scripture only to think that we're strong enough and righteous enough to stand.
That's right. There's a connection that needs to take place there. It says it was Satan's purpose to bring about an eternal separation between God and man. Did he succeed? Most definitely he did. Now, the original condition of man, as in the note here it says, he was perfect in his being and in harmony with God. Now listen to this. His thoughts were pure. His aims holy. Then what happened? Sin entered, then through disobedience, what happened? Powers were perverted, selfishness took the place of love, his nature became so weakened through transgression that it was impossible for him in his own strength to resist the power of the devil. It's like quicksand. The more he struggled, the more you get pulled into sin. Yes, brother. That's right. Yeah, what happens is when we focus on ourself, you notice that word self? Self causes a lot of problems. It's that I, the I in sin, the I in pride. The iniquity really showed up, you know, and it caused such a great problem. But you know, there's a solution. And the solution already was put into effect before man was created. And we call this what? The plan of redemption. That when man sinned, this plan was put into effect. And in Genesis 3:15, what are the famous words that we read there? And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. And what is this enmity? This enmity is the hatred of sin. You know, enmity, the Latin root of enemy, rooted hatred, state of opposition or opposed. So there's a separation. There's no likeness. And this was put into effect. Satan led man into sin, and the plan of redemption was put into operation. 4,000 years, Christ was working for man's uplifting, and Satan for his ruin and degradation. Here was the first promise of a Savior who would stand on the field of the battle to contest the power of Satan and prevail against him. We're not alone. When you're standing there, Christ is standing right behind you or beside you. He's holding you. He is fighting this battle for you and for me. Sister Lily?
I wanted to say what Sister Cheryl said, that this is not only appetite, but any type of addiction.
Exactly.
If you read here in the note, it said they ate and drank till the indulgence of their depraved appetite knew no bounds, so they couldn't stop eating and drinking.
Mm-hmm.
Internet to their phone.
That's right. That's correct. Now, what did God propose to accomplish through the plan of redemption? What do we read in Romans and in 2 Corinthians? To restore, yes, Brother Silva.
To restore his character, amen.
That's right.
The main work of the plan of redemption is restoration.
That's right. You know, when God created man, what did he say? It was... Huh? Well, he would have dominion. He would be in charge of all the animals and everything else. But was it good? Was it perfect? Yes. And here we see man, God wants to bring man back to perfection, back the way it was originally in the Garden of Eden. The race was not left without hope. By infinite love and mercy, the plan of salvation had been devised. A life of probation was granted to restore in man the image of his Maker, to bring him back to the perfection in which he was created, to promote the development of the body, mind, and soul, that the divine purpose in his creation might be realized. This was to be the work of redemption. This is the object of education, the great object of life. And then which of the three carried on with this plan of, well, they all carried on with it, but which one was chosen? We find out that the Son, Jesus Christ, was chosen for the Son of Man to seek and to save that which is lost, which was the human race. Because of his love, he died for you and for me.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, Brother Gillis? That's right. So going into this final section here too, what is God's ultimate purpose for his church? What is the purpose of the church? It talks about what? Yes, Sister Gillis.
The purpose of God's church is to reflect his image, efficiency, and his glory.
Amen. Okay, that's right. Can we add something else to that? What else can we add? Brother Joe. Yes.
Let me bring it a little bit closer to everyone who has children. What do you expect from your children? Well, to be here in that way, present you in a certain way. That's the same thing that God expects from us. To present him in this earth as his son and daughter.
That's right.
To be the way he wants us to be, to show the other people what man can be if he really connected with Christ and learning.
You know, in today's world, its courtesies are kind of gone away with. You know, it's not no longer yes, sir, no, sir. You know, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am. You know, you go first. You know, a lot of that has just been washed to the side. And it's a lot of the common courtesies is what Christ wants us to do. When someone needs a coat, we should give them a coat. If they're thirsty, we should give them something to drink. If there is a need, we need to fulfill that need, not to walk around as a Samaritan in the story of the Good Samaritan. You know, those that you expected would help, they didn't help, and the one that you wouldn't think would help, helped. Well, Christ came to this world to seek and save that which is lost. He came for you and for me. You know, he didn't need to come. He had a nice position in heaven beside his Father. You know, all right, man failed. He could have started over. But he had such great love for us that he wanted to carry it through and to fulfill his obligation. And if it was for one, he would have died. But he died for you and me, for all of us. And the ultimate purpose for his church is, as Apostle Paul said, look, I'm the least of one of the leastest of the saints. And my commission was to preach to the Gentiles. The church, it was called a repository. It was a storehouse of the grace of God. And what should we do? We should share this grace. We should share this love. It's the love should come from within, not an external a love that is just by word of mouth, but by our actions. The loudest sermon that was ever spoken was using no words. It was by actions. And what must be the condition of the church? Brother Joe had kind of touched it a little bit. It's supposed to be a glorious church, a church without spot or wrinkle, holy, unblemished, and united. As it was in the day of Pentecost, when the disciples were of one accord, the unity, love for one another, then we find out that the Holy Spirit was able to come in among them, and they were able to change the world. Because of that action, we are here today. We have received the Bible, this message. When he said, go throughout all the world, you remember where it started? Way over on the other side of the world, and here we have that message today. That is part of the commission that was given to them. Now we can carry it even further to other parts. And it might not be to the farthest parts of the world, it might even be right within our own families. Or it might be right with our next door neighbor. Maybe the one sitting next to you. Maybe the one that you meet in the grocery store. You never know. It is my wish and prayer that we do show our true love to one another, and that we may be able to share it with whoever we come in contact with. You never know. Are there any other points or questions that would like to be asked? Yes, Brother Dorval.
Mm-hmm. It's so wonderful to understand that Jesus Christ is still working with us. And there is hope for everyone if we look to him. He is waiting, as the Lord says, with long desire to see the manifestation of his himself, his character, in us. We are the church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim that as his own. He waits to see us as drivers.
That's correct.
As everything he himself. May we do not frustrate him anymore.
That's And what he had did was he had read, for those that are listening, on the last note under 5b, Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, these are the nice words here, then he will come to claim them as his own. This is my prayer, that he may come and claim us to be his own. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Paul, for your help.
You're welcome.
And everyone. At this moment, we're going to invite our ushers to come forward and pick up the offering, Sabbath school offering.
prayer.
Invite everyone to stand up and sing fervently hymn number 384. Hymn number 384. Prayer by Brother Paul Hazelhoff.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we can thank you for your many blessings. We especially thank you for the Sabbath day, that we could come from far and near to worship and to study. We pray as we go through the hours of the Sabbath day that we may keep it holy in our thoughts, words, and actions. We especially pray for the children, help that they grow up to follow thee. Help that we set good examples in everything that we say and do. And help us to be this glorious church, to be able to spread thy word wherever we go. And as we go into the second hour, we pray that the words that are spoken are for our each and every individual needs. We pray for others that are gathered on this Sabbath day that they may also receive a rich blessing. And help us to keep the hours of the Sabbath day holy. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We have only one announcement. 11 o'clock sharp, it's our divine service. So we are, at this moment, our Sabbath school is dismissed. So let us, if we have to go out or to, you know, restaurants and all that, to do it in an orderly fashion. Thank you.